This show is part of the RetroZap.com podcast network.
Hi, this is Vanessa Marshall, voice of Hera and Rook Cast, and you're listening to Dennis and Jay on Podcast Stardust. Their behavior is continually unexpected.
This is Podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Hello, I'm Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And welcome to another fully armed and operational edition of Podcast Stardust. This is the galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. And before we get to this week's discussion of Rebels, Jay, where can everyone find us around the internet?
We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And we can be reached by email at podcaststardust@retrozap.com.
So, as I was just saying, we are continuing our discussion of Rebels with this episode, and I'd like to thank everyone that's been listening. These episodes have been pretty well received. It seems like there's a lot of people that are out there eager to get back into Rebels now that the Clone Wars is over. So, thank you to everyone for joining us on this journey. I'd like to remind you before we get into our discussion that this is a full spoiler discussion. So if you haven't seen this episode or you're intending to and you don't want to get any spoilers about it, go check that out first and then come back. So I think I've given you a couple moments to turn this off. With that being said, Jay, can you go ahead and give us a summary of what this episode is about?
Sure. When the Ghost runs low on fuel and food, Kanan suggests they do a job for Vizago. The crime lord wants a shipment of weapons the Empire is moving through the planet Garel. Thus, the crew heads to the planet Garel on a transport in which R2-D2 and C-3PO are acting as Senate droids and translators. Ezra, Kanan, Zeb, Chopper, and Sabine cleverly discover the location of the weapons Vizago wants from Minister Tua and send the Imperials to the wrong hangar. After arriving on Garel, they sneak into the appropriate hangar and discover that the weapons in question are outlawed disruptor rifles that were used in wiping out Zeb's people on Lassan. Against Zeb's wishes, they return to Lothal to sell the guns to Vizago. However, 3PO, confused by all the action, contacts Agent Callus with their coordinates. As Hera and Kanan are making the sale to Vizago, Callus and the Empire arrive. Vizago departs with some of the weapons and refuses to pay the rebels. The crew of the Ghost fight off the Empire while Sabine and R2 rig the remaining disruptors to explode. Callus and Zeb duel in a one-on-one fight, and when Callus gets the upper hand on Zeb, Ezra unleashes a powerful force push to save his friend. After getting away, Kanan returns the droids to their owner and receives a reward. Once Kanan departs, R2 and 3PO's owner is revealed to be Bail Organa, and he is most interested in these rebels.
So, one of the things I love about Rebels is the simplicity of the storytelling. It's a good story. It achieves some things. I don't want to necessarily say Clone Wars is convoluted, but sometimes it's a lot more complicated than an episode like this was. And this episode just flowed. It had a great pace, and it really moved along. And it was refreshing to view in a way. What did you think about this?
I think that's a really great point, and you're absolutely right. And this is an episode, and much like a lot of the other episodes of Rebels as well, that you can just watch just by itself. It doesn't have to be part of an arc. It doesn't have to be, like you said, in reference to a bazillion other things going on here, there, and everywhere, that it has a good flow of action, that it does set up some storylines for later on, of course. Mm-hmm. But it also is just, it's just a really good story. Like you said, you couldn't have said it better.
I think you also put that very well. This story stands on its own very well, and it can be viewed without having seen anything that is around it, and you can be entertained. That being said, there are things that show up in this episode that become important in later seasons of the show. And even if you hadn't seen this episode, you could still enjoy those episodes and do just fine. without it. So with that being said, let's kind of get into some of the things that happen here. One thing that's going on is that Ezra is getting frustrated that he is not being trained by Kanan. And, you know, when they get to Gorel, they have him climb through the ducts and then jump from rooftop to get to the right hangar, because Sabine tells them that they, the Empire, that they need to go to Bay 17 when the weapons are actually in Bay 7. So Ezra gets into Bay 7 and unlocks the door and lets everyone in. But he kind of calms Kanan and says, you know, when are we actually going to get to the Jedi training? I'm thieving and I already knew how to do that. And then later in the episode, when they're back on the Ghost, Hera asks Ezra how Jedi training is going, and he says, Jedi training, never heard of it, because Kanan isn't actually training him yet. And it's not until later, when he uses that force push that almost came out of nowhere to save Zeb when he knocks Kallus away, that Kanan decides, yeah, it's time to start training this guy. So on the one hand, it seems perhaps Ezra's frustrations are a little premature because he just met these people. But on the other, Kanan was so confident at the end of the two-part episode, The Spark Rebellion, that we talked about, that Ezra had this gift that, you know, he's the one that extended the offer and invited Ezra to come and learn more about being a Jedi. So what did you think about this part of the story?
Well, two things, and I'll address your question about Kanan first, is, you know, I think some of it is that, yes, Kanan is definitely eager to train Ezra in a lot of ways because he knows that he's a definite ally, and to hone his force sensibilities or his force abilities in a way that can be beneficial is something that Kanan feels like he needs to do and is something that he can contribute. But yet I also feel that maybe Kanan is a little bit hesitant because it's kind of scratching open an old wound in some ways. And so, you know, maybe he's kind of putting it off for that reason. And you never know. I mean, there could be some other things that's going on with him as well. But the other thing I picked up on too here was the fact that Ezra almost looked like he was overthinking himself when he was jumping from those rounded rooftops to rooftops. And he had always just kind of done all those things on instinct, as we had seen in the first couple of episodes. But now it's almost like he thinks, oh, you know, I have this ability. And he was almost trying too hard in a way in some of those scenes. So I just thought that those were some things that stood out to me. But as far as Kanan goes, what did you feel?
Well, Kanan's relationship with Ezra is a central theme and aspect of the series going forward. And they have some frustrations, as we'll see, with each other about whether Ezra thinks Kanan thinks he's worthy. There's, you know, kind of a lot of typical teenager angst that goes on with Ezra and doubting, you know, whether his master believes in him, and he's thinking that his master wants to get rid of him. And then Kanan has some self-doubt because when Order 66 rolled around, he was just but a Padawan. He's never been knighted. And at this point, so yeah, I think you're right. There's definitely some self-doubt going on with Kanan about whether or not he can actually do this, whether he can train somebody, whether he's worthy of training somebody. At the same time, yeah, there might have been some second thoughts on his part, but Hera holds him to it. You know, she has that conversation with Ezra, and then later, as they're getting ready to depart the Ghost, Kanan is telling her, you know, as they're walking in a room that's got Ezra and a bunch of everybody else in it, you know, this isn't the time for it. But Hera says, that's fine, but we will talk about it, love. And so she is very much about Ezra's growth. And we've previously discussed how she's the captain slash mother figure of this group. And she recognizes how important it is that Ezra get that type of experience.
Now, the second time she's called Kanan love in the last three episodes. And, you know, not to give away too much here, but there's things that happen later on. Do you think that she just uses that as a general form of endearment, you know, a term of endearment for anyone that she's close to at this point?
Yes. And there's a couple of quotes that I remember from Freddie Prinze Jr. and Vanessa Marshall that came out around the time of these episodes. And they're kind of conflicting. And people were asking Freddie whether Kanan and Hera had this type of a romantic relationship. And his response was, that's already happened. They just don't have time for it right now. Whereas Vanessa Marshall's response was just what you said. It was kind of a term of endearment that she uses for the people that are close to her, that, you know, okay, love, and that she didn't see anything more of it. That being said, like you said, we know later on that there's more to the relationship than this. And they have, but they have different views on the way that the Spectre cell should be run. And, but they're very affectionate for each other. If you go back and read the novel New Dawn, which takes place before this,
right,
there is a clear attraction that between those two and that book, but we don't know exactly how their relationship evolved. It's always kind of been something that simmered there in the background. And then we're told at the end of the series that it was a lot more serious than was displayed on screen.
Right. And that's why I asked too, and your reference to A New Dawn, you plucked that right out of my brain, because we do see their relationship evolve a lot in that novel. Mm-hmm. But there's kind of a gap between that and where we end up here. So there you go.
Definitely. Well, let's move along then and talk a little bit about Zeb. So he is really stunned when they get to Gorel and they discover that the weapons that they're supposed to get are these outlawed disruptors. And there's a lot of elements that we can talk about here. And there's some that probably deserve more attention than others, but one, it's just kind of an interesting point. The Imperial Senate outlawed these disruptors, but the Empire has had these disruptors developed as prototypes so they begin mass producing them again. What we know about the disruptors is that they can take down a starship with a single rifle, the way that they activate. And we get to see Kanan use one against an ATDP at the end of the episode, but they are even worse against organics. And that's what the Empire used against Zeb's people. And so as soon as he sees these, he wants nothing to do with them. He wants them destroyed. Are you a little surprised that Kanan wasn't a bit more sympathetic about this? Because Zeb pulls Kanan aside and says, yeah, maybe we don't sell these to Vizago. We just flat out destroy them. And Kanan's response is, well, we sell them to Vizago. We get some money. We keep them out of the Empire's hands. It's a win-win.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I did pick up on that, definitely. And I was actually a little bit stunned by that, because it's obvious that Zeb had some major PTSD as soon as he saw those, and rightfully so. And, you know, so I wasn't quite sure. I'm glad that you said that, because I felt that way too. And I wasn't quite sure, you know, where or why that he was portraying it that way. But I guess it was more of a pragmatic, practical kind of a approach to it overall. But yeah, right. I was a little puzzled as well.
Kanan was often described as the cowboy Jedi as this series was getting off the ground. And I guess it's moments like these where that reputation becomes earned. Whereas over the course of the series, I feel like he really retreats from that type of behavior and becomes much more of a thoughtful Jedi.
I agree. And it's funny that you say that, because it's hard sometimes now that we're revisiting these, because once you get to see that character development and once you get to see their arc from beginning to end, you identify with them more, you know, where they ended up as opposed to maybe where they were at the beginning. And so I often find myself, as we've been revisiting these, trying to back my brain up and kind of put myself back into that first time viewing sort of a perspective. And it can be a little hard. I mean, it was a little difficult in this way. So, because it seemed out of character for him.
So do you think his evolution, or what I'm calling evolution, is actually character evolution? Or do you think it's more of a case where this is a brand new series, this is episode 3, and perhaps the writers and the cast and everyone hadn't actually nailed exactly what this character was yet?
Maybe a little bit of both, but I tend to kind of lean a little bit more towards the character development side of things, because I just feel like, especially with Dave Filoni, he is the kind of person that he knows exactly where he wants to end up from the time he starts. Sure. And so, yes, I feel like that maybe there were some things, some elements in the story group, or perhaps some influences that maybe took things into that other slightly different direction as making it up as they went along. But I think overall, I think that Dave had this vision, and I think the story group had a vision.
Well, it's not necessarily the story group that was creating this this episode. The Sword Group is much more of a here's what canon says is a resource type of a thing.
Right. But I think more broad.
But the writers for the show, I think, perhaps are the better description. But a couple of things. One, when Dave Filoni was brought in on the Clone Wars, he was working with George Lucas. And who knows Anakin, Obi-Wan, Padme, and the Jedi, you know, Yoda and all them, better than George Lucas. Those are not new characters. The only new characters were Rex and Ahsoka. You know, the main characters, I should say, out of that. You know, eventually got the likes of Hondo and Cad Bane and stuff like that. But even then, they had George Lucas's input. And these were additional characters in a galaxy that was well established. Rebels was a brand new creation for Dave Filoni. And these are brand new characters that hadn't appeared in movies and didn't have a background to fall on for character development. So I think that these characters definitely evolve. That's clear over the course of this series. But I'm kind of wondering if, and especially when we talk about characters like Kallus, if they really entirely knew what they wanted them to be from the get-go. And it wasn't through writing a few episodes or producing a few episodes that they really nailed their tone. Because I wonder if this episode had been maybe episode 6 instead of episode 3, if that's the decision they would have made for Kanan at that point. Mm-hmm. But, you know.
That's a good point.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think, and not to say that Kallus is a secondary character, but he kind of is. Right. So I can see where the evolution kind of is almost on, like on a need to know basis, on a need to do basis. But, you know, another point to Kallus too, is that as we see him in this episode, he revels in the idea of taking Zeb out and just putting it right in his face that he had that, that force pike type thing.
Bull rifle.
The bull rifle. Yes. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I've been thinking a lot about what we said the last episode about what you had mentioned with Lucasfilm and, you know, the writers of Rebels putting a lot of stock into making us want to buy into his evolution later. Mm-hmm. And, you know, but I think as Star Wars fans, we look for reasons to allow people to have that redemption. And, you know, you think about Vader, you think about Kylo Ren. I mean, there's been so many instances of horrible, evil acts of things that have been done that we have completely excused.
I don't disagree with any of that. When it comes to Kallus, there is some inconsistency in his character now and what we'll see in later seasons. And it's hard to talk about without getting into the discussion of those episodes. And so I it's just one of those things I keep wanting to remind people of, because we are going to have eventually a big conversation about Kallus when we get to a later episode in season 2 or 3. I can't remember which one. I think it's season 2. But the thing is with Kallus is that he brags to Zeb here that he retrieved this bow rifle from Lasat Honor Guard, you know, because Zeb is infuriated that someone other than an Honor Guard's got one of these weapons. And then he basically taunts Zeb that you fear these disruptor rifles. I know why. I'm the one that gave the order to fire them. And he's then standing over Zeb ready to deliver a killing blow. Okay, they're combatants. You can almost get over that. But he's not exactly presented himself in a way that's likable, and he's, to the contrary, he's presented himself as someone who has no remorse for these things.
Mm-hmm.
But later we are asked to accept that that's not the case. So again, this is going to be an ongoing conversation that we have, but to me it kind of feels like perhaps the writers changed their mind on this character as they went along. And eventually they have to come up with some explanations for things that are a little harder to swallow.
I can concur with that.
So
I'm sitting here trying to think, you know, there's just so much psychology to the character of Kallus in general. And like you said, we'll get into a lot of that later on. But yeah, it's just it is a very interesting relationship for sure that we have with Kallus.
Sure. So I kind of touched on some of the bigger things. I want to get into a few other things that happened in this episode. When at the beginning, they've escaped TIE fighters and you know, they didn't get the shipment that they're supposed to get, and you know, everyone's kind of giving Kanan a hard time. You know, he's all excited because they got away, and I knew we would. But then Sabine is like, you said we would get away with the shipment, and they didn't have it. And that's when the whole conversation comes up that they don't have enough food, they don't have enough fuel, they don't have any money. And so they're going to run this job for Vizago. So they head to a starport, and they get on a ship that's going to take them to Garal. And this ship is not identical, but it is modeled and is similar to the ships that you board when you are at Hollywood Studios or in Disneyland for the Star Tours ride, which is the ride that takes you through the movies. It's not part of Galaxy's Edge, but it's the, if you're not familiar with it, it's the ride that you board and then you get, they kind of mix things up. There's an introductory scene. There's a longer ride scene. There is a communication scene, and then there's a concluding ride scene. And there's at least, I don't know how, just the introductory scene has three different versions I can think of. And then parts one and two have a dozen different versions they can have. And then the person who communicates in the middle, there's four or five different people who contact you. So you literally have dozens upon dozens of different combinations you can go through this ride. So that's Star Tours. This is not about that show. But you are on the speeder. And it, when the ride originally came out, you didn't have all that variation. You basically kind of were boarding Star Tours to go on a tour. And then you had this incompetent droid named Rex, who was voiced by Pee Wee Herman himself, Paul Rubens, who was your guide. And you kind of go through this adventure and then eventually end up back at the hangar and it's over. Well, they replicate this with a similar ship. And then they have a new droid named RX-24. Who's voiced by Paul Rubens, that is the pilot for this thing. And it's been one of my favorite Easter eggs and cameos in Rebels ever, and well, actually all Star Wars animation, and it still is. It brought such a smile on my face when I was watching that today to see that droid interacting with the crew of the Ghost and R2-D2 and C-3PO.
That is so cool. And I just love the way that some of these things, as you said, these Easter eggs are just intertwined and interwoven into the fabric of these stories, because it really does put a smile on your face.
Uh-huh. The other great Easter egg that appears there on that shuttle as they're flying to Garal. So they have to create a distraction because Minister Tua is there talking to this Aqualish, whose name is Ambo Wabba. And he's got, or she has got, C-3PO and R2-D2 there. They're Imperial Senate droids. They're signed to the Imperial Senate. But she's using 3PO to translate for her as she talks to Wabba. But then Chopper and Ezra stage a disagreement where Chopper is zapping Ezra, kind of like, you know, I'm not touching you, I'm not touching you, I'm not touching right. you. And so finally, Ezra loses his cool. And then Minister Tua ejects, and Rex, RX-24, says that the droids have to go to the back. You know, astromech, your astromech is going to head to the back. And then Ezra says, well, if my astromech has to go back there, then their astromechs have to go back there. And so that's how they get R2-D2 and 3PO over 3PO's objection that he's not an astromech to go back to the back. But so Chopper kind of has a confrontation with R2-D2 and C-3PO, but there's another droid standing there back there with them. And it is Ralph McQuarrie's original painting. A 3PO
yes.
back there.
Yeah, you talk about Easter eggs. That is a very cool one.
And so much of what we see in Rebels is what Ralph McQuarrie's take was on these concepts in the first place. It just kind of fits right in because Chopper is actually more similar to the original take on R2-D2 than R2-D2 is. You know, mm-hmm. with the arms that come out, the grappler arms and stuff like that. So it's kind of funny. You get the post, or I should say, you get the pre and the post version of R2-D2 and C-3PO standing there in the back of that shuttle.
Mm-hmm. And as we said before, too, with Zeb even, he was a concept of Ralph McQuarrie for Chewbacca or the Wookiees.
Right.
So, yeah. And again, you know, just those throwbacks to all of these different concept designs that were being used. So a couple other things I love about this scene is I love the way that the Ghost crew are such great actors. And, you know, they pull these things off all the time, but they're just like a well-oiled theatrical little machine when it comes to some of this stuff. But I loved seeing R2-D2 and Chopper kind of going at it and sort of the battle of the wits kind of thing throughout, which is a lot of fun.
Definitely.
Oh, and I have to say, too, Kanan seemed to recognize R2. Am I crazy? in thinking that, but there was at one point where he looks at R2 and he kind of gets this look on his face. And I wanted to go back and see if there was any indication that he may have seen him before, either in the comics or even in Clone Wars, now that we have that, you know, I don't want to say retcon, but in the newest season of Clone Wars, where we see that little tiny hint, you know, of Kanan standing there around the holotable. So did you catch on that?
I didn't. I can't dismiss that point, though. I mean, we've talked about it quite a bit in the past, how, well, we were just talking about it when we were talking about The Empire Strikes Back, when R2-D2 gets to Dagobah with Luke, and he and Yoda seemingly don't recognize each other, despite the fact that they've both been to that planet together. And of course, the Lars don't recognize 3PO or R2-D2, even though 3PO was in serving that family for a while. So maybe Kanan did recognize R2-D2. Maybe R2-D2 looked like another astromech droid he's familiar with. You know, there's been quite a few comments across Star Wars about how droids are as common as appliances. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, oh, that looks like my old dishwasher. Yeah. So I don't know, but I'll have next time I watch this, I'll have to look out for that.
Yeah, it caught me, and I didn't get a chance to take a look at any of the other supporting material. So,
yeah, you know, it didn't come up in the episode guide. And I got to tell you, when it comes to the episode guides, they have not done them as well as that they did for Rebels. They've got so much great stuff on an episode per episode basis over at StarWars.com for these episodes, whether it's the episode gallery, where it's got all the different, you know, stills as they kind of recap the story there, the Rebels recon that Andy Gutierrez does, and she talks to Pablo Hidalgo and Dave Filoni and the cast and the crew. They've got the trivia, they've got the concept galleries, they have articles about the top 10 things that we learned from this episode or we enjoy about this. It's great in this day and age where we can go back and watch all these episodes of Disney Plus, but then you can go in and just dive into all this stuff and find out so much stuff about not just the episode, but Star Wars in general on the episode guide. So if you get the time and spend some time with the episode guides for each one of these episodes after you watch them, and you can pick up quite a few things and find some of these Easter eggs and where the ideas came from, what the influences were. And, you know, they did like a social media question every week on Rebels Recon. That's always fun to hear the explanations and the answers too. So definitely check those out.
Great suggestion.
So the last thing to cover in this episode is that at the end, you know, they didn't get any money from the sale of Vizago because he double crossed them, and they've driven off Callus and the Empire there on Lothal. And R2-D2 suggests that, or C-3PO, or both of them combined, doesn't really matter, that their owner is very fond of them and would pay handsomely for their return. So they make contact with Bail Organa without realizing it's Bail Organa, and they return 3PO and R2-D2, and Bail pays them rather handsomely, as best we can tell. And then he is there posing in that same kneeling position, putting a data card in R2-D2, similar to what Leia did at the beginning of A New Hope, to get information. So it's kind of that's one of the things that they pointed out on the episode guide, is that it was supposed to be reminiscent of that scene so that he can find out more about these rebels. Cause we all know behind the scenes, he's building a rebel alliance. I really liked the end of that episode. It was a short thing. They didn't belabor any points about it, but it was a nice little breadcrumb that leads us to this crew eventually joining the Greater Rebel Alliance.
Right. And I love that Bail pulled out that quote, "The simplest gesture of kindness can fill a galaxy with hope." And to which Kanan replies, "Hey, that's an old Jedi saying."
Yeah. Yeah.
That was really cool.
And we all knew who it was Bail Organa. Because we'd seen him in the Clone Wars. We'd seen, you know, what Jimmy Smits looks like, and he looks like Jimmy Smits. And so there was no mystery there. But I liked that little clue was left there for Kanan, because this is not the last time we'll see Bail this season. And there's a pretty big reveal when it comes to him later in the season as well.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, I think it's time to wrap this one up. Did you have any final points you wanted to make about this episode?
No, I think we pretty much hit on all of it, quite honestly.
Yeah. Well, it's funny because, you know, I enjoyed it. I enjoyed it at the time. I thought it was really great seeing R2-D2 and C-3PO. If you haven't watched this one recently, but you enjoyed Rebels, I highly recommend you go back and watching it again. These are just good Star Wars fun. They haven't gotten into some of the wilder Force aspects of the series just yet. And then, of course, the Mandalorians come up in later seasons. But these, as you put it, Jay, kind of more isolated episodes were just as fun as anything we get later, and definitely worth your time and investing the interest in going back and checking it out again. But with that said, I'd like to thank you all for listening to this episode of Podcast Stardust and our discussion of Droids in Distress. And we'd like to remind you that you can find all episodes of Podcast Stardust over on our home at retrozap.com. Plus, you can subscribe to Podcast Stardust wherever it is that you get your podcasts, whether that's Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Overcast, Google Podcasts, you name it, we're there. And if we're not, let us know, and I will work towards getting us there. And, of course, we are part of the RetroZap Podcast Network. If you subscribe to the network feed, you'll get this show and all the other great RetroZap shows in one convenient place. If you've got 30 seconds, one of the best things you can do to support the show would be to head over to Apple Podcasts and leave us a review along with a 5-star rating and just a couple sentences about what it is that you enjoy about the show. That helps out in the algorithms with others finding us and what we are all about here on Podcast Stardust. So, Jay, can you let everyone else know where they can find us on social media and around the internet?
Sure. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. Dennis is at DJKVER2 over on Twitter, and I am at Joyce Krebs. You can also check us out on Pinterest. We have a YouTube channel with all of our episodes and all of our unboxing videos as well. And you can also email us your thoughts at podcaststardust@retrozap.com. What did you think of this episode of Rebels? Did we miss anything? We'd love to hear your thoughts. And if email is not your thing, you can also join us over on our Discord room on the RetroZap Discord server, where we have our own room as well as all the other great RetroZap shows as well. And there's other dedicated rooms for talking about all kinds of spoilerific kinds of things. And you can find out how to do that on the community tab in our show page. And we'd also love it if you could support us on TeePublic, where we are teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust. And there's all kinds of really great products over there. I actually just got a new racer back tank top to wear out on the trail running because it's getting mighty hot these days in the summertime. So it's a very comfy tank top and I really highly suggest it. So again, teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust. And thanks to Corey Club from Coffee with Kenobi for producing all of those great designs for us.
All right. Well, that'll bring us to the end of episode 110. Thanks for listening, everyone. And until next time, may the Force be with you.